the next three lectures. So the first lecture of tomorrow will be given by Nicolò De Fenu, who unfortunately cannot be here because he's in the US. In fact, he's in Boston and will give a talk from Boston tomorrow. So we have agreed on a sort of a presentation of the quantum part, which will sort of mirror some of the things that you have seen in the classical part. So the beginning will be on sort of mean field quantum, so systems that you can think of similar to the Q-revised type of model in the context of classical systems. Of course, if you do a quantum treatment, it will be slightly different, so you will have to do with matrices, and okay, this is something you will see, but it is slightly more formal and slightly more difficult, but the concepts are very much the same. So you will see that, for instance, ensemble inequivalence in the quantum models will be arising near first-order phase near first-order quantum phase transitions. Also, you will see some properties of the 1 over r to the alpha interaction, which is fortunately today accessible in experiments on atoms in cavity, confined ions, and also you will see dynamics. So you will see how the quasi-stationary states arise in the quantum versions. So these will be the subjects of the next talk. Today is my last talk, so this is devoted to more advanced and recent work that I have been doing. Essentially, it is the product of my interaction with
recording Ivan, in progress
with Ivan Latella, who is now at in Barcelona, and we started a collaboration 6-7 years ago, and. So it was a sort of occasional collaboration. So he was working in the field of non-equilibrium thermodynamics, and so we started to discuss. We began to discuss about his own approach to those systems, and we realized that there was a very close contact with systems with long-range interactions, and in particular. Today, maybe I should select. Okay. So I will sort of make a step backward. This is the, formally it is the fifth lecture, but in fact, I will never give the sixth lecture because it took to me more time for the first lecture, so I splitted the first lectures in 1A and 1B, and you have the notes of 1A and 1B. And then, okay, finally it's six lectures. This is the sixth lecture if you count properly the number of sessions that we have held. So I will go backward to the first lecture today, with concepts related to additivity and long-range interactions, but I will discuss this topic in a wider sense, so in a thermodynamic sense. So for sure you have knowledge of thermodynamics, and you will see that thermodynamics, as usual, is an amazing science. So it's. Sort of able to give in a very simple relation a lot of information on the system, and okay, so And then after having a watch to the thermodynamics aspects of long-range interactions, you will see how it's possible to see the counterpart in StatMech. And so today will be devoted to the introduction of a new ensemble that maybe you never heard about. It's an ensemble where the number of particles fluctuates, the energy fluctuates, and the volume fluctuates. So all the three fluctuates. So I'm sure that you have heard about ensembles where two of these quantities fluctuate and the third is fixed, okay? But never heard about an ensemble where the three of them can fluctuate. And the reason is that one can prove that if the interactions, this was done by Guggenheim long ago in the 30s, that if the three quantities fluctuate all together, there are no equilibrium states. So you cannot have equilibrium states if the interactions are short range, if the three quantities fluctuate. Of course, you can add the fluctuating quantities, external fields. So this is for a fluid system, no? For a system of particles or the system that you have seen, okay, is the minimal set of thermodynamic quantities that define a thermodynamic system. While if the interactions are long range, there can be equilibrium states. Not only there can be equilibrium states, I will show today a model that besides having equilibrium state, it has phase transitions, and also phase transitions are and phase diagrams are inequivalent to phase transitions in the other ensembles. So it's a new ensemble that appears due to the long-range interactions. And since it is new, we had to give a name to this ensemble. We have called it unconstrained. It's with no much of imagination. So in some sense, it's free to do all what it wants. It's free to do energy fluctuations. It's free to do volume fluctuations. There are profound things about, I think, about these aspects that long-range interactions allow this new ensemble. I would say that as a suggestion to understand why this ensemble exists in long-range interactions, you can think that usually what you have to do when you have a gas, you have to put the gas in a volume, okay? Otherwise, okay, you get a divergence. So the entropy diverges, the free energy diverges. Now, systems with long-range interactions can present situations in which you don't have to put them in a volume. So they can reach a bound state which doesn't touch the boundaries of the system. And this bound state is free to fluctuate. This is more or less the idea. So the interaction is long enough that you can form bound states that do not fill the volume. Okay, so this is very intuitive, but you will see that it has a degree of foundation. This type of argument. Then I will apply this the tool, the unconstrained ensemble, to a model that was introduced in the 70s by Walter Thiering, and which is, in fact, I consider this paper, I will put it in the Slack, a sort of a pioneering paper in the field, because nobody understood the problem like Thiering in the 70s. And the problem of negative specific heat, and he correctly, since the start, put this problem in the context of ensemble inequivalence. He introduced the model in the microcanonical ensemble that you will see can be solved in both ensembles, canonical and microcanonical, and also in this unconstrained ensemble. And so it's a very simple model, and it contains a lot of information. And then I will discuss also how to perform simulations in this new ensemble using Monte Carlo, which is adapted to this new ensemble. Okay, so this is a series of papers that I will put in the folder that started in 2015. So let's start the game. Okay, as you have known, that the additivity is a basic property of systems with short-range interactions. It implies that energy. Okay, let us look at additivity in a different way. Instead of looking at additivity as a property of the energy itself, let's put it in relation with the homogeneity of thermodynamic potentials. Okay, this is another way to look at additivity. So, in this new sense, additivity implies that energy is a linear homogeneous function of entropy, volume, and the number of particles. This is, by the way, the property that you use when you derive the thermodynamic relations that imply energy, entropy, volume, and number of particles. For instance, the way you write the work, as in the so-called TDS equations, I used to call them in this way, but I will repeat this scaling property in a while, so you will see where I use the additivity. Now, as we have seen, the systems with power low decaying interactions are non-additive if the power alpha is smaller or equal than the dimension d of the embedding space. In fact, we have not seen many cases in which alpha equal d. It's a sort of limiting case. It's an interesting one, for instance, dipolar systems. And okay, there are many examples in physics, self-gravitating systems, Coulomb and dipolar systems, but also two-dimensional fluids like the atmosphere. So there are plenty of applications in this field of the tool that we have learned. And the non-active interaction lead to ensemble inequivalence, which implies negative specific heat, temperature jumps, broken ergodicity. So there are plenty of new phenomena, quasi-stationary states, plenty of new phenomena that arise in this field. Okay. So just to put this in context, let us think how Gibbs introduced the so-called grand canonical ensemble. So the idea of Gibbs is that, that it costs an energy to change the number of particles. Okay. So you have a system, and Gibbs thought of copies of the system, several copies of the system that are distinguishable, but they can have different number of particles. And having or not having a certain number of particles costs an energy. Okay, now let us generalize Gibbs' idea. So now you have copies of a system that is a long range. Each of the system is long range. And it can have a certain number of particles, a certain energy, a certain entropy, and you are making copies, replicas of this system. And each of the system has n particles, energy, entropy S, and volume V. Okay? What changes in this game? This.
Giulio, could you please switch off your mic?
I thought it was my glasses.
Giulio Tani Raffaelli.
Okay,
thank you.
I will switch off everything. So the only thing that varies is the number of copies, okay? So the total energy will be the number of copies times the energy of a single system. The total entropy will be the sum. There is no interaction among the copies. It's like in the Gibbs construction. There is no interaction between copies of the grand canonical. And so the construction is very similar, in fact, to the construction of Gibbs. So the total volume will be the total number of replicas times the volume of the system, of the single system. The total number of particles will be the number of volume. Okay. So now, okay, so this is very much inspired. I advise you to read the work of this guy, Hill. So the idea of Hill was different, but is very much this. Connected with this one. So instead of creating copies of the system, he subdivides a single system, which is interacting in parts. And in fact, the name that he gives to this energy is the subdivision potential. So you can write a thermodynamic relation for the total energy, which includes the variation in the number of copies. Okay, you see that it comes after the Gibbs term. So the variation of the energy, of the total energy, might be due to a variation of the entropy, TdS, to a variation of the volume, minus PdV. For historical reason, there is a minus here. It depends on the sign of the work. Then the Gibbs variation, which is the chemical potentials times the variation of the number of particles in a single system, plus a term which takes into account the number of copies that might cost energy. Okay. So we will see in a very simple way that in the case in which each single system is additive, the cost of adding a copy is zero. While if each single system is long range, it's a bit magic. If each simple system is non-additive, then it will cost an energy to add the copy. So let's do it. So the proof is two lines. So you change the number of copies by a factor xi in such a way that the entropy is divided by a factor xi, the volume is divided by factor xi, and the number is divided by factor xi. N is n total. Huh? Okay, so is the n total, you do this on the total quantity. Then, of course, you just apply these relations, and you see that if you do like this, the variation of the entropy of the volume and of the number of particles is zero. And this implies that if this is zero, all this is zero on the right-hand side, there is a direct relation between the variation of the total energy and the variation and the the replica energy epsilon capital E. Okay? But in additive systems, the energy is a linear homogeneous function of the entropy. So the energy of the system 2 is nothing but the energy of the so you see that I have to divide by factor xi. And therefore, dT is 0, which implies that E must be 0. So if the energy is a linear homogeneous function of its arguments, the replica energy is 0. But we know that for long-range systems, this is not true. So there must be an energy associated with the fact that you add a copy, that you add a copy to the system. I remove my... Okay, so now you have to work a little bit with thermodynamics. So this is the integration of the Hill equation for fixed single system property. So I fix the numbers in the single systems, and just one step, you prove this relation. So if you divide by the number n of systems, you get this explicit relation that relates the energy, the entropy, the pressure and the volume, and the replica energy. You have to do it to be convinced that it is okay, okay? It's just one. So I put all the ingredients to do it, okay? Then you differentiate this relation, and you take into account, go and look in a book of thermodynamics, to the first TDS relation, to the first TDS equation. And you get an equation for the variation of the replica energy. Okay, this is a relation that appears in thermodynamics book. It's called the Gibbs-Duhem relation. And you see that usually this Gibbs-Duhem relation has a zero on the left side, which implies that you cannot fix temperature, pressure, and chemical potential independently. They are related by an equation of states in additive system. But here, because of long-range interaction, you have an extra term, which is due to the variation of the energy associated to the variation of the number of copies. So the Gibbs-Duhem relation is violated. So this is one news. The Gibbs-Duhem relation, which usually take for granted in thermodynamics book, is violated, but simply because in thermodynamics you assume that that the system is additive. If the system is non-additive, the Gibbs-Duhem can be violated. Moreover, if you integrate this equation, you can get an equation for E. So if you are able to compute, calligraphic E for the replica energy, so if you are able to compute in a given ensemble, for a given model, you are able to compute the thermodynamic functions and the equation of state, then you can write explicitly what is E. Okay. So it's not mysterious, this E. You can compute it. So the first thing that we did, and I will not repeat the historical steps, was to compute this E, this calligraphic E, in several different cases. For instance, take a system in mean field with decaying interaction, compute E. Or take the Turing model and compute E, for instance, in the microcanonical ensemble, since the model was solved in the microcanonical ensemble. So we took some time to familiarize, maybe you will see in the papers, but I don't want to follow the historical thread because it will be too long. So the procedure will be slightly different, more logical. So after we convinced ourselves that this E was calculable on some models directly, we started to think in a different way. So, and this different way is, okay, since Gibbs needed a new ensemble to to formulate the problem of changing number of particles, there should be an ensemble that takes into account the variation in the number of copies, okay? And this ensemble is this one. It's very simple to write, in fact. It's a probability distribution where you have three Lagrange multipliers, one for the number, one for the energy, and one for the volume. So there is no mystery in that. So, and then the corresponding partition sum is a partition sum where you have to, here the energy is discrete, but you can replace the sum over the energy states by an integral over the energy, or of course you can replace by the sum over the volume. Everything in the continuous limit will be replaced by this, and so then the change in average energy can be written, you now that at the expression, as a change in the probabilities, okay, in the usual way that you do for ensembles. There's a question?
No. Yeah, so the index I runs over the copies on the replicas, right?
The index I is the energy states. You don't see here the replicas. You see the single state, okay? You see the single, this is the probability distribution of the. Okay. So this can vary, okay? The probability distribution of the single state can vary, and the variation induces a variation in the energy. So now I rewrite the variation in the energy using the conservation of probability, and I obtain a relation, this relation, where n bar, v bar are the average number and the volume. And this is to be compared with this thermodynamic relation, okay? Which now allows to identify the thermodynamic functions. So you can write the temperature in terms of the multiplier beta, the pressure in terms of the multiplier gamma and beta, and the chemical potential in terms of the two multipliers. And this is the entropy associated with this construction. So then substituting this relation in the expression for the probability in the entropy, you get the expression of the replica energy. This is where the replica energy enters, okay? So from the thermodynamic relation for the replica energy, and having computed these averages and the entropy, I can obtain the replica energy, which is nothing but, as usual for the other ensemble, which is nothing but KBT times the logarithm of the partition sum for this ensemble. Okay? And by differentiation, one obtains the relation for the replica energy. So you can see that in this ensemble, the entropy the entropy is minus the derivative of the replica energy with respect to temperature at fixed pressure and chemical potential. The volume is the derivative of the energy of the replica energy with respect to pressure at fixed temperature and chemical potential, and the number of particles, you fix the other two. So you fix 2/3 and you get the fluctuating, the average fluctuating quantities. Okay, so the, this is the construction. It is okay, and of course there are Legendre transforms to the other ensembles. So I can write the partition sum in the unconstrained ensemble, for instance, in terms of the partition sum in the ensemble in which temperature, volume, and number of particles are fixed by simply Legendre transforming with respect to this would be the canonical ensemble, no? This is the canonical ensemble. So I Legendre transform with respect to the number of particles and with respect to the volume, and I obtain the partition sum in the unconstrained ensemble. Okay, this is would be the canonical partition sum. But I could also obtain it from the grand canonical partition sum, which is this horrible symbol here, by Laplace transforming with respect to the pair pressure and volume. Okay, so I have several ways of deriving this new partition sum. And this is a graph where I show all the ensembles that we could that we can construct by this type of construction. So I start for the entropy, with the entropy, which is the thermodynamic potential in the microcanonical ensemble, where the energy, the volume, and the number of particles are fixed. Okay. Now I can let the energy fluctuate, and I get the Massier potential, or the free energy if you want, in the canonical ensemble. In this construction, as you have seen, I'm losing the invertibility of the Legendre Fenchel transform. So there can be response functions that have not the right sign. And in this case, the response function, which can become negative, which can be negative in the microcanonical ensemble and must be positive in the canonical ensemble, is the specific heat, which is the response function with respect to the energy. So the variation of the temperature with respect, so the variation of the energy with respect to the temperature. The inverse of the variation of the temperature with respect to the energy in the microcanonical ensemble, while it's a variation of the energy with respect to the temperature in the canonical ensemble. So they have two different expressions, these response functions in the two ensembles, okay? And in one ensemble, it is necessarily positive. I'd call the ensemble in which you let the fluctuation be free, okay? So, by instability, that was described by Matteo, for instance, in systems that are mixed, it will be the instability in which the system demixes and reaches the higher entropy. And this we have discussed at length, okay? We have discussed this problem at length. We have seen many models in which we can do this step, and the specific heat can be negative. Okay, now there are two possible ways. Either you free the volume, okay? Either you free the volume and you go to the pressure ensemble, which is this, which is the ensemble that the chemists love more than the physicists, because everything in nature is a constant atmospheric pressure, okay, so or the ensemble that the physics, this is the first deviations of physicists from chemists, from chemists. So physicists go this way and chemists go this way. So they go towards the pressure ensemble, and there is an associated response function, which is the compressibility, which is which can be negative in the canonical ensemble, but is necessarily positive in the isobaric ensemble. So when you release a constraint and you go to what could be called the higher ensemble in which you allow fluctuations, here is the most constrained ensemble, is the microcanonical. Everything is fixed, energy, volume, and number of particles. Now you go to the isobaric, or you go to the grand canonical, where you let the number of particles fluctuate, and you have another associated, now I don't remember the name of this response function, but you have another associated response function in which you can, that is necessarily positive in the canonical ensemble and can be negative in the grand canonical, in the grand canonical ensemble. Is the response associated with the fluctuations of the number of particles. Now, the two lines join in this new ensemble. So if you let in the grand canonical fluctuate the volume, okay, then you reach the unconstrained, or the alternative, you let the number fluctuate in the isobaric, let the number fluctuate in the isobaric, and you reach the unconstrained, which for Massier potential as beta times the, it was a bit lengthy, but this is the panorama that we have in front. Okay, so, and all types of inequivalences could be checked at any of these steps. So there are models in which you can check inequivalence at any step when you release a quantity that is fixed in one ensemble. So today we will concentrate on the new inequivalences that arise because of the existence of this new ensemble. So the inequivalence of, for instance, of the unconstrained ensemble with the isobaric ensemble. And in order to do that, I need a model which is adapted for fluids. Okay.
No, yes, so these inequivalences are always associated with the first order phase transitions.
Yes.
In all these
yes, cases. Yes. In general, yes. I would say that is a general feature is that the associated thermodynamic function should have a region of where it is with a supporting line. So there should be a non-concavity of one thermodynamic potential, and this can appear only at first order phase transition, no, not at second order phase transition.
The coexistence essentially of.
Yeah, you must have coexistence, a region of coexistence of the two phases, yes. I have no general proof of that, but this is what is should happen in all these steps, yes. And also in the example that I will show today, it is like that. Okay, so I think now it is clear, and it is even very general what I have shown now. You see a general. So if you have questions on that, because I will now go to the model.
Questions?
So.
No, everything clear?
Yeah, it's a bit shocking the fact that you have so this new thing. Yeah. So even for us it was so not easy to accept. We had convinced ourselves that.
Okay.
No, I was just wondering because when we spoke previously about replicas in all other courses, where when we are averaging over disorder and we take the copies of the system with different realizations of disorder, so I was wondering if this is like the underlying mechanism behind this, or this has nothing to do.
We didn't have a good name for these copies. So we call them replicas. Gibbs called them copies. So we decided to call them replicas, but they have nothing to do with the problem in random systems.
Okay.
So these are distinguishable copies of the same systems. This is the definition of a replica.
Okay.
Okay, so now let us go to a model that I like a lot. It was proposed by Walter Thiering. In a paper that appeared as I have the copy that I will put on the web is a CERN preprint, and I like very much this paper. It's very well written. And it starts by asking how can be that specific heat is negative, and then it's a bit lost in the beginning, so it starts by trying to average the issue was raised by Lindenbell and Wood in a paper in 66, and there was no answer to this issue, and the statistical mechanics community was sort of skeptic about the fact that an astronomer was questioning the basics of statistical mechanics by saying that specific heat could be negative. So they were a bit suspicious that this guy, although he was a famous astronomer, he became a professor in Cambridge and one of the most famous astronomers in these years. So maybe he was a little bit too arrogant and to say things that statistical physics community didn't like. Okay, but Thiering had the right attitude. So he tried to understand. So in the first part of the paper, he tries to do a trick to deal with gravity, with Newtonian gravity. And the trick was the entropy construction that we have seen in the Lindenbell paper. The trick was sort of averaging over boxes. So he was taking the system, and then was trying to have an idea what happens if you average over boxes, and he gets a formula at the end of this first paragraph, where very complicated formula that he can rewrite to the. So his objective was, of course, to compute the entropy, and his idea from the start is very clear that he was thinking to ensemble in equivalence. So that the only way out of this dilemma put by Lindenbell was understanding what happens for thermodynamic entropy, for microcanonical entropy. So it was pointing to the inequivalence of ensembles from the start. But then in the second paragraph of the paper, he says, okay, I have all these boxes, but what if I replace by just one box? So, and that's very simple. In fact, it's a fantastic idea because everything is clear and you compute it in two lines. So you have a system now, it's put in a box, okay? You need a box. At that time, of course, people wanted the box because with gases it was like that. So it doesn't work any. Okay. Yes. So, and you have kinetic energy and you have potential energy. And the potential energy essentially counts the number of particles that are in the inner box. the number of particles that are in the inner box means that if you have a pair of particles that are in V0, in the volume V0, which is contained in the volume V, is smaller than the volume V, then if they are together, they interact and they attract each other with a strength minus nu, okay? So this is a theta function, is the theta function of the volume V0, and if the position of the particle is in the volume V0, and also the other particle, the particle I and the particle J must be in the volume V0, then they attract with a potential phi. Okay, if one of the particles is in the volume V0 and the other is outside, it doesn't count any energy of interaction, they are free to move. And if both are out, they don't interact, okay? So then I will finish the lecture by showing the entropy and the free energy of this model. But okay, so the total potential energy in the large end limit is just minus nu and zero square. So you just count the number of particles that are in volume V0. Okay, so that's the problem. And you have to solve the microcanonical entropy. Now, I leave it to you, because from the knowledge that you have of counting with the spin models that we have seen, so I give you just two steps. First, you have to do the integration over the momenta, which is easy to do. So you write the delta, and you integrate over the momenta. It's a Gaussian integral, so you can do it. And then you have to do the integral over the positions. Okay, but the integral over the positions, it is very simple, no? Because you have to integrate over the position dq1, dqn over the particles. And particles can be only in volume V0 and in volume V0 on in volume. So essentially, there will be. So, okay, so you have to remember that you have to, this is, so, okay, you have to integrate some integrand after having integrated over the momenta. And so the relevant counting factor is n factorial divided by n0 factorial, which is the number of particles that are in the volume V0, and n minus n0 factorial. This is the relevant counting factor. Now, this n factorial will be killed by the Gibbs paradox factor that you put in the omega. So you remain with that, and then you have to maximize with respect to n0. So you count all states. So you have to count all states irrespective of what is in the zero value. And there you use the saddle point. No? You have to maximize at large n. You have to, so you use the Stirling approximation. You do the large n. It's really very simple. You get the results. And these are the parameters as Tilling were putting them. So this is the number of particles, the ratio of the number of particles that are in the gas phase. So 1 minus n0 over n. So these are the number of particles that are in the gas phase. This is the rescaled energy. So since the energy in this model is growing like n squared and it has not been, yes? Yes, sure.
Maybe it's a very stupid question, but why are we dividing by n0 or the interaction term by using the factoric? Because, I mean...
In this expression?
No, in the previous slide, like in the definition of the Hamiltonian.
Why we don't divide by n0 square here?
No, by n0 in the definition of the Hamiltonian for the interaction term.
Ah, yes, there is no, this was a time in which they were not using the Katzeli scaling, so I do it naively as they were doing. Very good question. So there is no Katz scaling, so the system is finite n for the moment. And in fact, if you do the thermodynamic limit without doing the Katz scaling, you run into troubles. And what Turing did was to define the energy in a different way. So he defines the energy dividing by n squared, and then he divides the temperature dividing by n. And in this way, since the temperature is the kinetic energy divided by n is intensive, okay, and the energy also is intensive. And the reason of this plus one is that in this way, all the energies are positive in the model. Okay, it's just a normalization. So it's a different scaling, but it is equivalent to the Katz scaling in the end. Okay? He could have done introducing the Katz scaling since the beginning. Thank you for the question. So it was a bit sloppy. And this parameter eta is very interesting because he, for some reason, so he likes this logarithm of this because in the previous calculation, he had a ratio between the volumes that was exponential of some function. So then he calls the scaling factor for the volume, he calls it exponential of this. He was calling it F, but F makes confusion with the free energy, so we decided to call it eta. Okay. But these are exactly the parameters that he used in the scale. Then, if you do this integral there, you get this entropy, which is the sup over the fraction of the number of gas of this expression. You see that again, this entropy has some fermionic flavor through this term. And this is, okay, this is the part coming from the essentially from the kinetic energy. So this entropy does not have the decreasing part that we have seen in spin systems. It's an entropy of a gas, essentially, of an interacting gas. So if you put more energy in the system, the energy which is not taken by the potential energy will be taken by the kinetic energy. So the volume will keep increasing, okay, as you put more energy. So the entropy will never decrease, so it will always increase. It's a generic feature of system with kinetic energy. It's the first one that we see, in fact. So it's important to... You could check, for instance, that if you define a microcanonical temperature using this expression for the entropy, there is no negative temperature region. So this is even more clear, because sometimes you could tend to associate the negative specific heat to the negative temperature. Okay, this is a system without negative temperature. So all temperatures are positive for all the states. Nevertheless, the specific heat can be negative. And then you have canonical free energy, which is, as you see, I have to divide the free energy and take the inf. So essentially, this is the Legendre-Fenchel transform of the canonical free energy. And what he finds? He finds a plot. Unfortunately, I wanted to add a slide on this, but okay, the original slide. But I take it from a paper that we wrote recently. So we realized a couple of years ago that no one had computed the phase diagram of the model. So we decided to compute the phase diagram of the model, and the situation of ensemble inequivalence that appears here is again associated with the first order phase transition, which is different in the two ensembles. So you see that in the okay, tau is the rescaled temperature. Okay, tau is the rescaled temperature. So I'm plotting the phase diagram in the two variables, the rescaled temperature and the parameter eta. And I can compute the critical point in the two ensembles by expanding, by using a Landau expansion in the order parameter, which is the fraction of the volumes, so the order parameter is a density in this case, And if I use the variables adapted to the canonical, so the intensive variable adapted to the canonical ensemble, I get a line of first order phase transition with an endpoint, which is here, which is a second order phase transition in the canonical ensemble. And if I do it in the microcanonical, exactly, you remember that area that was at the form of a fish in the models that we have solved, spin model. In this case, is this area here, which are states that are not accessible in the microcanonical ensemble. And in fact, if you cross these, so for instance, at fixed temperature, you cross this area here, there is a jump in eta. I remind you, eta is essentially the log of the fraction, of the volumes, the external volume. V0 is a parameter of the Hamiltonian. You have to think of V0 as a parameter of the Hamiltonian, while the volume is the volume containing the gas, which is fixed. When I take the thermodynamic limit, I let the volume increase with the number of particles that increase in such a way to have a constant density. But V0 is a parameter of the Hamiltonian. By the way, there is a very interesting limit that you could do, is when you take the volume to infinity, you could take the volume V0 to zero. And in this case, you eliminate the negative specific heat phase because you go back to a short-range interacting system. So V0 is a sort of finite in the large volume limit, okay? So is affecting a finite part of the system, and this also is one of the ingredients of the inequivalence in this model. This, if you want, this is a modern way of looking what Turing was looking. Turing was always putting himself in this region, so he had a jump in density and a jump in temperature, and he was never looking at the full phase diagram. Okay, we decided to look at the full phase diagram, and the full phase diagram is the following. So you have a critical point, which is not the same in the two ensembles, as for the Blume-Capelle model and for the... They don't agree, the two. In this case, it's the critical point. So we have to solve a discussion at that point because, coming also to the question of Matteo, so where I should expect ensemble inequivalence? Near first-order phase transition. Now, in this case, the first-order line is not the same, you can see. But there is no tricritical point in this model. So there is no region of second order and first order transitions. There is a line of first order transition in both ensembles that finishes in the critical point. But the positions of the two lines and of the position of the critical point are not the same. So that creates the ensemble inequivalence. So the phase diagram is intrinsically different in the two ensembles. Okay, so this is ends, if you want, the first part of the lecture. I took 1 hour. And in the second part, I will show the application of the formalism of the unconstrained ensemble to the theory model. Now, the problem that we had when we tried to apply the unconstraint to the Turing model is the Turing model is not rich enough to create states in this new ensemble, equilibrium states in this new ensemble. So we were very depressed because we were convinced that there were states in this new ensemble, but we could not find them with the Turing model. So you will see that the trick was to enrich the Turing model, to put, if you want, unphysical pressure from outside. So if besides attracting the particle in the volume V0, you push the particle that are outside into the volume V0, then you get equilibrium states. So the model was not rich enough in parameters in order to give equilibrium states in this new ensemble. But, and I think if you take other models, you have to play with parameters in such a way that that you get equilibrium. It's not for given that you get equilibrium states in this new ensemble, but we were expecting them, and okay, you have to modify the theory model in such a way to allow a richer. And then, okay, we were looking for phase transitions, and I remember I gave a talk 2 years ago in Buenos Aires before the pandemics, and I put the question to the audience, we could find equilibrium states, but we could not find phase transitions. And then when we started to discuss this, then, okay, the idea was to put the particle with an excluded volume. So the final step is to have a theory model with an external pressure plus a size for the particle. And if you put all them together, then you get everything. Equilibrium points, phase transitions, and ensemble in equivalence. So you have to sort of enrich the model.
So just to see, I mean, what you mean is, are you changing the Hamiltonian?
We are changing the Hamiltonian.
So by this pressure term, how do you change the Hamiltonian?
You will see. So okay. I add a term in the potential energy.
Okay.
I will do it explicitly. Okay. I add the term in the potential energy, which introduces a pressure from outside. So yeah, I have to change the Hamiltonian in order. So if I study this model in the unconstrained ensemble, I don't get equilibrium states.
So it's like, so if you want to get a picture, it's like thinking of these particles inside a inflated balloon, which lives in a system with pressure P.
Yes, yes. Okay. Yes. It's not, I don't know how physically it can appear, but okay. It's an unphysical modification of the.
Without V0, this is an ideal gas, right?
It's an ideal gas.
It's an ideal gas. So
it's an ideal gas.
It exerts pressure on,
yes.
Or even say, on a free piston.
You could think also. I think if one does a sort of a repelling particle, so if the particle, so in some sense the particle should attract when they are in V0 and should repel when they are in V1. This would be also analogous.
So they are not free particles?
No, even when they are in V1. So here they are free particles when they are in V1.
Okay.
In the Turing model they are free particles. Okay. But when they are in V1, they repel. So they attract if they are in V0, or they repel if they are in V1. How to do this, I don't know, because they are the same particles. Why they should repel in V1 and attract in V0? So one could think, for instance, of shining a laser in the inner part in order to change the sign of the interaction among the particles. No? Particles that naturally would repel, if you shine a given region, then they should attract. This would be the physical way of, I have no idea, it's totally unphysical, but one has to think of a way of realizing this. I think in social interaction it's easy. So either you like each other or you don't like each other. If you are in the bad place, you can hate each other. I think with unphysical systems and non-physical systems, it's easy to think. But it's okay. I think okay. Just to finish, I think the idea of Turing, I find it very interesting, and I think he's a pioneer. In this solution of the problem, although people attribute this to others, Lindenbell and others, but I think this paper by Turing is really the corner point of the solution of the puzzle. And this model that I'm doing in the last lecture should have been in the first lecture, but for historical reasons, for logical reasons, it's better to introduce ensemble inequivalence in spin models that are models of magnetism that are more, I mean, easy to solve in some sense, that are more familiar to us. But I think this model is a really fantastic way, and is the solution of the puzzle put by Lindenbell in '66 with finding the. By the way, Turing, I knew, just a personal story. I met Turing several times, and I've been honored to serve also as in the committee of the Erwin Schrödinger Institute in Vienna that he created. And he was an amazing person. So I remember once during a dinner for his celebration of maybe he was 80 or something like that, he said, in physics, I tried in physics always to find confirmation of something, and I always find a contradiction. So, for instance, also this way of thinking is very interesting. So you can work to confirm a basic thing, no? And but if he was saying that. In trying to confirm something, you find the contradiction that leads you to another direction, and so I think it was a very interesting lesson also. And he has several examples of this kind in his papers, where if you look in detail what the theory that you have, you discover aspects that at the first sight you neglected, and they are important, and. This leads you to new directions of investigations. Unfortunately, this paper, 1970, remained a sort of unknown. So, for several years, I think we discovered it at the end of the 90s. So, it was a sort of unknown. This paper. Okay, 5 minutes of break then. I hope to finish at 1.
So we take 5 minutes break.
Recording stopped.
Metti semplicemente, fai semplicemente la recente sforzo, tiri in modo e non funziona. Non c'hai.
Statico. Se tu prendi l'ensemble, se prendi l'ensemble a pressione costante o.
Ti bastano 20 minuti. Ok, so we start again. Hello? Hello? So we start again, thank you.
Recording in progress.
Sorry, it was a problem with the microphone. So we are...
Sorry, I forgot the microphone. So I repeat, there is an extra term in the, which is a repulsion in the volume. Now maybe I am wrong here. I don't remember, so I have to check the sign. But I'm sure it is a repulsion for the case in which we have states. And then this is the modified theory model in one dimensions, in two dimensions, and in three dimensions. So particles have a size, and in the volume V1 they repel, and they attract in the volume V0. So this is more or less the picture. So then I compute the canonical partition sum, so already Turing did. And then by Legendre transforming, by Laplace transforming, I get the unconstrained partition sum. So I have to solve this problem here. It's not difficult to solve. I do it as usual with Laplace method. So unfortunately, there is one aspect, it is technical, but it is important, that the volume, I've told you that the volume of Turing is this one. You see that it's, this is now explicit. This is the integral that you see on the blackboard, the integral over the positions, divided by the Gibbs combinatorial factor. It's a sum over n0 and n1 with the constraint that n is the sum of n0 and n1, so there is a Kronecker delta here. And then in the Turing case, there is no sigma, so it's v0 to the n0, v1 to the n1, divided n factorial and n factorial, okay? But in the case in which there is a sigma, in which there is a size for the particles, the expression is correct only in one dimension. So there are corrections in dimension 2 and dimension 3. So in fact, when we published the paper, we were not aware of this difficulty. We were not expert enough of equation of state for systems of with part. So So now we have a paper that we are preparing that corrects this mistake that we have in this in this paper. So this is the first time you see an expression. So this is the replica energy at volume V0, at volume V, and with a certain number of particles. This is the explicit expression of the replica energy. And here K is a sum over 0 and 1. Okay, there are two containers. Either you are inside V0 or outside V0, and there is an explicit formula for the, so you can compute. And in the, then you use the Stirling approximation, then you do the saddle point, so large N, and you get the replica energy. And the replica energy is a function of the thermodynamic parameters of the system. So it's like the entropy, the free energies. So it would be zero if the system were additive. And clearly this system is not additive because the energy goes like N square. So the system is not additive, and so you get a finite thermodynamic potential, epsilon. In order to express this thermodynamic potential in terms of the three parameters that now fix the state of the system, so which are pressure, chemical potential, and temperature, you have to solve this set of consistency equation. Okay, so you see that they are implicit. So because you see that temperature appears here, for instance, so you have to invert. You have three equations and three unknowns. Okay, so you have to invert in mu pt as a function of the averages, because here everything fluctuates. So the volume fluctuates. So you have an average volume. Okay, the number of particles fluctuates. So you have an average number of particles both in the inner part and in the outer part. And you get them as a function of T, P, and mu. For instance, when sigma equals zero, we get this. We get this. And it's very interesting, the form that is taken by the replica energy is minus the potential plus PV. So if you go and look at the thermodynamic relation, you see that it is related to the thermodynamic relation that we wrote in the first part of the talk. So we have also sort of reasoning where we take the excess part of this quantity with respect to short range. So in some sense, there is a long range contribution to the pressure. There is part of the pressure that comes from the gas. But what appears in this relation is the pressure due to the long range minus the pressure which is due to the standard short range gas. Okay, so this you can see in these expressions. So it's a long and tedious work to do. So we have a long paper about that. Here I essentially recall some results. So equilibrium configuration, so for sigma equals zero, so when the particles do not have a size, like in the Thirring model, equilibrium configurations exist in the unconstrained ensemble only if B is negative, so for repulsive interactions. For B equals zero, which is the Thirring model, no equilibrium states exist in the unconstrained ensemble. And then there are other features. For instance, the unconstrained ensemble and the grand canonical ensemble are equivalent when B is negative. in the grand canonical ensemble, equilibrium states exist also for B positive. So also when both are positive, also when you have both attractions in the two regions. And some of these states have negative isothermal compressibility. This is one of the response functions that can be negative. No phase transition is present in the canonical ensemble, in the grand canonical ensemble. The grand canonical ensemble is inequivalent to the canonical ensemble. And in this latter ensemble, so in the canonical ensemble, phase transition of first order and critical point is present, is in analogy with the Thirring model. And moreover, negative compressibility states appear in the canonical ensemble also for B negative. So there are different behaviors in the isothermal. Now that we have a very complicated set of ensembles, we can check several properties. And they are different in the different ensembles, depending what choice of parameters you do. All that for sigma zero. Sigma non-zero, as I've said, is correct in one dimension. So we introduce a new set of variables, which because in this case we have A and B, okay, so slightly different from the set of variables that Thirring has, so adding a feature. And then we have a different form so this is the replica energy rescaled, also for sigma positive. And the new feature is that with sigma positive you get phase transitions. For instance, here is a first order phase transition. I'm now plotting this function, which is unusual free energy. So it's a free energy that does not exist for systems with short-range interactions, okay? And here I show that by varying one parameter, I have one case in which a minimum is here at these values of x0, which is the fraction of rescaled fraction of particles that are in the box v0. The minimum is here, so I have a state here, and this is a metastable state. And if I change a parameter, in this case xi, I don't remember, is one of the rescaled parameters, maybe the chemical potential, I go from this minimum here to this minimum here, so I have a phase transition of first order by varying one parameter. And it can be very complicated, so you see here the space of parameters is larger, so this is the analogous of the opening of the forbidden phase in the plane that will not now appear in the space because I have more parameters. So it's slightly difficult. This gray surface there delimits the region in this three-dimensional space where I can have states. Below on the other side of the gray surface, I don't have states. There are no equilibrium states. On the left side, there are equilibrium states, and there is a line in the unconstrained ensemble of a second-order phase transition with two surfaces, and the upper surfaces and the lower surfaces delimit the region where there are no states. So you have jumps. If I vary, for instance, if I vary X bar in the vertical direction, at some point I have a jump, like temperature jumps, this type of discontinuities that we have seen in the simpler models. It's a richer situation, a richer model. This is, for instance, an example of inequivalence of isothermal isobaric with unconstrained. In the isothermal isobaric, I have a line of first-order phase transition ending onto a critical point. In the case of the unconstrained, I have a line. I have a spinodal line, one could call it. So a line which delimits states that do not exist in this ensemble, and finishes on a second order critical point. So I have a very unusual situation. And this is something like a cut in the previous three-dimensional plot. So I'm cutting a specific region of. These are really details. So I could give other details of these models, OK? And this is very recent. This is the example how you do simulation. In this system, you need two reservoirs, one for the particles and one for the volume. And then, OK, it's simply Monte Carlo acceptance and probabilities for configurations. So you have to move the particles around and then compute the acceptance rate according to how you vary the energy. And here the energy is more complicated because you have the energy is the replica energy. So you have to count in a new way, okay? But it's a standard Monte Carlo. So now we have, for instance, here is a simulation where we don't put the inner volume, V0 doesn't exist, and particles only repel, and they stay in volume V0. So particles stay in volume V0 and they only repel. And there are equilibrium states, and we reach this equilibrium state with Monte Carlo very precisely, you see. So these are the lines that this model can be easily solved. Is in the class of Turing models, and it's easily solved, and then we compare the analytical solution with the numerical simulation. And this is a rather different case in which now I'm comparing isothermal and isobaric. There is a size for the particles now, and there is repulsion. And you see that you have a typical situation of inequivalence. So in one ensemble, I follow the line, and I reach metastable states, and then I have a region of inequivalence, because this quantity cannot increase in one ensemble, while in the unconstrained, I have a first order phase transition in the unconstrained. It's very similar to the Maxwell construction that you have seen in the first lectures. So as usual, when you go in an uncharted region, you try to explore. So we are continuing the exploration of these different models in this uncharted region of the Turing model. But of course, one could try also with other models and also more realistic models. So in these lectures, I've tried to convey the idea that in long-range interactions, we have a new ensemble which can have equilibrium states, phase transitions like the other ensembles. We are calling this ensemble the unconstrained ensemble. The thermodynamic potential for this unconstrained ensemble is the replica energy. The replica energy can be computed explicitly, even analytically, in some models. I have not shown, but it can be computed also for 1 over r to the alpha interactions in the mean field approximation. And the unconstrained ensemble can be equivalent to the other ensembles, but cannot also, so there are cases of inequivalence. It's just an exploration that is going on. We are now using equations of state for fluids in 2 and 3 dimensions to correct the solution that we have published, which is valid only in one dimension. And that's all. I think since it's my last lecture, I think I can leave it open for discussion. And if you have also questions to put on previous lecture. So just, starting note. From tomorrow, Niccolò De Feno will give at 4 will give a lecture on the quantum mean field Ising model.
Okay. Questions?
Don't be shy.
Anyhow, you will be here.
I will be here tomorrow.
Yeah.
And I'm available for.
You will do the teaching assistant of
I will
Niccolò.
Do the teaching assistant. Yeah. I will try to reproduce the calculation of Niccolò because some of them I don't fully control. So because I'm not so. I don't know much about quantum systems. So, yeah. But I wanted to give a flavor of. With these three more lectures, how all these things are being now exported to the quantum domain, finding features that are similar, features that are new, so it's interesting.
Okay, so I think we can close here and have lunch. So thank you again.